Mark D. Cedar Theater Center. Normally I say we are at the Grandis at CUNY, but today we have the great honor and pleasure to be here at this truly legendary place where the poetry and performance has a home. I'm sure you all know the history of this place. If not, do look it up. Not only Allen Ginsberg and many, many others were here, but it's a fantastic spoken word place, and please do follow them and what they offer in this community, especially here in the Lower East Side. It is exceptional. It's one of the few places we feel that in New York that make New York, New York and Manhattan, Manhattan. So thank you for coming out on this kind of cold and rainy day. I know we need good, great theater, great place, but we also need a great audience. So really, thank you for coming. My name is Frank Henschken. I'm the executive director, the director of the Siegel Center. And together with PEN, the Literary Festival and the Writers Organization, we created the International Play Festival. We had contributions from Australia, from the Ukraine, from Turkey, from Brazil, Guinea, and from Germany, and now we are moving to Syria. So this is a significant festival, most probably the most important one in North America, what we are participating with. At this moment, over 80 writers from all over the world are here in town and participating in the dialogue that was created by Salman Rushdie, Paul Auster, Michael Roberts, and many others in the first Bush years of the government, where people felt America has a tunnel vision and we need to open our eyes and listen like musicians do to world music, to global music, also theater. People have to listen to voices from around the world. Penn always says, you know, the statistics say 95% of all books published in the US are from English-speaking countries, and the 5% that are left, 2.5% is German or French because it's supported, so there are only two books out of 100. And it is not enough. We need to understand what is going on. We need to hear the stories to understand ourselves, but also the world we are living in, and to find meaning. So what we hear today, the stories will bring me, I think, achieves that, and I think we have a fantastic lineup. This was a very good year. We have done this now for over 10 years, so thank you for coming. The Siegel Center, British Academia and Professional Theater, International and American Theater. This is one of the most significant days and events, and that's why I'm talking so much. I'm so excited and happy. And I would like to thank Brooke, our festival producer, and Soria, the assistant curator, Antje Oebel, who curated with me. There's Rebecca Soria, who is the associate curator, and there's Michael and Brad over here, Joy Arab, who helped us out, and Mia, and so many, many, many others, Bella from Brazil, and so many people who were here with us, and it's a great honor. So if you have a cell phone, please do take it out this moment, just to make sure it's off. I'm going to do the same. And now we will hear a play by Rama Haidar, which is Desert of Life. And Rama, where are you? Here she is. She flew in from, she lives in Spain at the moment. It was very, here she is. Yeah, please, an applause for her. It was not easy to get here. The visa was rejected, but also the help, you know, of the Cuomo's office, the deliverance office, other we were able to handle voices. Lawyers help us to bring her here, so it's a fantastic little miracle that happened, that it all worked out. And it is translated by Rama in collaboration with Rebecca Magor, who is also the director. Rebecca, where are you? Over there, who is also at Cornell University. And now we're going to hear Desert of Life by Rama Haidar. Thank you.
Desert of Light, a play in one act by Rama Haidar. The play begins with excerpts from two poems by
script says I, a selfish optimist, will whisper to my enemy, whispers to himself.
He and I are partners in one trap. And in the probability game, we wait for the rescue rope so we can part ways.
By the edge of the hole, the chasm.
And go to what remains for us of life and war.
If we are able to survive.
The second excerpt is from the poem by Mahmoud Darwish, Under Siege.
Here, there is no I.
Here, Adam remembers his origin of clay.
And now, Desert of Light by Rama Haidar. We have Guy A, Guy B, and a silent militia. Setting: overwhelming chaos, neatly arranged, a brutal siege. The action takes place in one of the abandoned buildings. The sounds of bombing, shooting, and combat aircraft circling above play a central role in the rhythm of the text. They reverberate nearby and far away. A home, a couch, an unmade bed, a refrigerator, a sink full of dirty dishes, a cupboard. There is a door next to a small shuttered balcony. The room is indistinct. It could be a kitchen or a living room. The only light source is a bulb hanging from the ceiling. Guy A sits silently on the couch.
Man, you should have seen it. This bomb hit the ground and made a crater. We couldn't even get in there. We couldn't get close enough to drag the old man's body out. Abu Muhammad's corner store? It's gone. The best part was this boy playing soccer in the neighborhood before the bomb landed. He kicks his ball way down the street, runs after it, then the bomb falls in the exact spot where he'd been standing. He doesn't even look back, just keeps playing.
He tosses the ball up and down in one hand. He turns and throws it at A, who stands unresponsive.
What time is it?
Sounds of bombing from afar. He picks up the ball from A's feet.
You've been silent for over an hour. It'll calm down now, a little. The boys told me they'd help us get out.
Silence, followed by a burst of bullets.
Do like everyone else did. How do you think everyone else got out?
Oh, that way? It's that simple? We do like everyone else?
No, man, we just sit here and wait around for the UN to save us. I hear they waved a fleet of limousines through the checkpoint just this morning, door-to-door service.
B throws the ball forcefully at the couch, narrowly missing it.
Tell me, how can you think so fucking highly of yourself?
Just calm yourself. I'm not in the mood to fight with you.
Sounds of shelling from a distance, followed by a round of bullets.
You're scared. I can see it. Man, when I was coming here, it felt like a real live game of Counter-Strike.
Got you, bitch! Got you! What's wrong with you?
There's no other way. If we don't get out now, we're stuck here, under siege. You have any idea what that means?
No idea. Truly, enlighten me. Let me understand. According to you, we're not under siege right now? Anyhow, let's assume we get past the sniper and the shelling. What about the military checkpoints?
Oh, so now you want to talk about the checkpoints? I thought you were a fan. You're the one always saying the camp would collapse without them.
When did you ever hear me say that?
You said the rebels don't know how things work.
Which by default makes me a fan of the military checkpoints? You think I'm a fan of the military? And them preventing the UN relief cars from getting into the camps?
Stop saying stupid shit about how the boys don't know how to deal with this situation.
Look, you start getting these things mixed up. You're fighting with me and focus on devising a way out of here.
Now you're angry with me?
I told you, look, I don't want to fight.
Did you
you get the cigarettes?
How about you ask your friends at the checkpoints for cigarettes?
Huh?
Honest, hardworking soldiers, salt of the earth.
Yeah, yeah, enough of your sarcasm. Listen to me, my friend. I'm not leaving, because I'm scared for you.
Scared for me?
Oh, indeed.
And why are you scared for me?
Because they will shoot you at the first checkpoint.
No, my friend, don't be scared for me. Be scared for yourself. My boys have everything under control.
And who are these dudes you're always talking about? Your boys. Your self-proclaimed rebels. Give me a break. You put your pathetic life in their hands?
My boys are out there trying to help us. They are getting the people out. But since you're such a fucking coward, you're not willing to see it.
Yeah, and just how are they getting people out? Flying them out with helicopters? Your boys found some magic alternative that does not involve passing through the very same military checkpoints and standing around waiting at the camp gates? They're all taking advantage of this siege, and all we get to do is choose between these devils and those devils.
We get what we need from them, and then they can go to hell.
And you don't know shit about politics. You think they'll just let...
Thought you didn't want to fight.
That's right. I don't want to fight with you. Tired of you. I'm bored out of my mind. These past 2 weeks in here, I've gotten to know you better than the 26 years we've known each other out there. You go out for 4 days and you come back with nothing. No answers, not one piece of useful information. And you can't come back reciting the exact same shit as before. I mean, aren't you tired of yourself?
B takes a cigarette from his pocket and puts it in his mouth. He searches for his lighter.
You gotta be kidding me. You go out there, you see the situation for yourself, then you show me all the useful information you pick up. And I want to know what you learned about me. Look, I went out there to try and understand where the hell we are and find a way out. You think it was a fun time?
He takes out a lighter and plays with it, provoking me.
So basically, I'm tired of you too. And now I want to know, what did you learn about me? Enlighten me, inform me, Mr.
I learned that you're an idiot. I learned that anyone can manipulate your mind and this whole struggle. You're just pretending, just talking. Your whole life is like this shirt. You wear it, you take it off. Now give me a cigarette.
A shirt?
That's right, a shirt. It doesn't matter who or what these people are, as long as you get what you want. For God's sake, give me a cigarette!
He takes a cigarette out of a tin in his pocket and hands it to A, who lights it with the lighter.
I'm thirsty.
Don't be annoying.
Sounds of bombing. Closer this time.
Let me understand. What's your plan for getting us out of here? Where's your stuff?
My stuff? You can lick my stuff. Piece by piece, brother. I've got nothing left. You think I'm ready to die for a bag of shit like the one you drag around your back everywhere you go?
A combat plane circles. Bombing. He moves towards A's bag.
And what's in that bag of yours anyway?
None of your business.
A's cell phone lights up, announcing a call. He checks the caller ID. Does not answer. Ring, 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 ring. The bombing continues. The sounds of shelling grow louder. Ring, ring, ring.
Why don't you answer the phone?
It's my mom.
A combat plane circles, and then there's a sudden strong explosion moving nearby. The entire room seems to shake. The electricity cuts off. In a very dim light, maybe dusk, maybe dawn, the phone lights up again. As soon as the bombing stops, he answers.
Hi, Mom. It's all good. We're good. We're good. How is everyone? Yeah, did Ahmad get back? Did you get the fuel? Where's Alaa? Did he buy bread?
Don't waste the battery, the boys are gonna call.
Yeah, yeah, Mama. No, there's just some kind of clash outside. Leave me alone, you and your fucking... It sounded far away, yeah.
Bag and opens it. He starts searching through it, picking through the items, curious. unwraps the papers piece by piece until he reaches the bottle. He opens it excitedly and takes a long swig. He notices me drinking from the bottle and panics.
Yeah, okay, Mom. Don't worry.
He chases me around the room, trying to grab that bottle for
me. No, don't worry. It's in God's hands. No, it didn't blow up near here. Hello? Ma, can you hear me? Lost reception. Put the bottle down!
I'm thirsty.
That'll make you thirstier, you clown. Put it down.
Brother, I need a drink.
It's in the bottle.
Don't tell me this is the same bottle of wine from that failed New Year's Eve, 2004. You saved it? You took it with you? Till now? Damn, thought you'd have drunk it a long time ago.
He drinks as he talks.
Truth be told, nothing bothers me more than your fear. Not your fear of the war. Your fear of losing memories. There's nothing left to lose. There aren't even any ruins for you to stand on. Why are you so scared? Tell me.
Give me another cigarette. Put the bottle down.
I only got 3 cigarettes for the both of us. I couldn't get a whole pack.
He offers Abe the bottle and a cigarette. Yaya snatches them violently. Abe takes a long swig, then immediately lights the cigarette. He approaches the bag again. Glowering, Guy A gives Guy B silent permission to search through the bag. He takes out different items from the bag and comments on them. Books, family photos. Couch. He finds a Palestinian flag and gently folds it and places it back inside the bag. He reaches deep into the bag and pulls out a compass?
A compass? You took a compass with you? Oh my God, you think a compass is gonna lead you anywhere? Don't you know all our problems began with a compass? It points you in a certain direction, shows you the way, and you start walking and walking in that direction, and you keep walking and walking, and then nothing. This is one big bag of make-believe. That's what happened to us in 48. We trusted a compass, and now look where it's got us. Stick up the ass. Biggest stick of our lives.
Sounds of bombing from afar.
Brother, this history is not trustworthy. I'll tell you something. From now on, we are the compass. The only compass. Well, it's like this. If I leave the camp now, I won't be running after any make-believe. This time, I'll get to where I'm going for sure.
Why are you looking at me like that? Whatever. Take it or leave it.
You see how I'm holding this? Look. You see that? It's pointing down to the ground. It's a piece of shit compass.
Tell me, idiot. Your father never told you how to hold a compass?
He throws the compass on the ground. It shatters. A combat plane circles above. A bomb explodes very nearby.
Wow, that was loud. Yeah,
fuck. That's it. Give me the bag. Why did you open the bottle without asking me? How many times?
All private stuff. Look, this here bottle now is common property.
Or do you want us to die before we drink
it? Yeah, I wish you dropped dead before you opened it.
No joke. You're the king of failed relationships. The king of many endings. Oh, no. The king of new beginnings.
Another faraway bombing.
You know what? Fuck the motherfucker who put me under siege with you!
He stands and grabs the bottle in his hands. He closes it and walks away. Then opens it and takes a sip.
Speaking of the siege,
Lena got out.
He takes the bottle from B and takes a long drink.
To Damascus?
He snatches the bottle.
Yeah, most likely.
Why are you telling me this now? I mean, with whom? Whom? With her husband?
He grabs the bottle, takes a deep gulp, closes it, sits, holds the bottle tightly.
Sit down. Tell me what you know.
What do you want me to tell you? Give me the bottle.
How'd they get out? What about the shelling? And the checkpoints? And the sniper?
Pass the damn bottle.
It passes the bottle.
How'd they get out?
I help them. I talk with the boys.
He opens the bottle and sips from it. A stands and snatches the bottle from him.
Lie to me, and I'll kill you.
He gets up and crosses to one of the open cupboards.
Brothers, there's nothing to eat here?
It closes the bottle tightly. He rewraps it in the papers and places it in the bag. He reorganizes the belongings and puts them back into the bag. He closes it with care. Another bomb falls.
There's salt.
He peers into the cupboard and finds a box of salt. He pours himself a cup of salt. He licks his fingers, eating the salt with a dreamy smile.
Salt is nice. You want some salt?
And you gotta tell me, is Lena all right? Did you see her? Was she scared? I mean, what did she talk about? I mean, did she ask about me?
Whose house is this anyway? This house we're in, how is it possible they left nothing?
How'd she get through the checkpoint?
Brother, I told you, I talked with the boys.
And what did you talk with them about?
Don't you trust me? And this shit about putting on a shirt and taking off a shirt? You think I'm messing around?
Give me a cigarette. Give me a cigarette.
Last one, man.
How's it the last one? There's two left.
There's two, bitch? Unbelievable. And those last two are mine.
He takes out the lighter and makes to light the cigarette.
Show me your lighter.
He jumps up and snatches the lighter from his hand.
This is mine.
Give it back.
They struggle over the lighter.
All right, fine. It's yours. Everything is yours, brother. Take it all. But let's get out of here.
A sits down. He smokes.
Yesterday, I dreamt I was walking in the old neighborhood. It was night, but the street lamps were working, which was weird. And I saw my father walking towards me from far away. He took hold of my shoulder, turned me around to face the horizon, and as I was turning, the buildings around us, they were falling, and some were burning. Time returned to sunrise, maybe sunset, and the whole world transformed into green mountains. There was this powerful, blazing light. And my father pointed at the mountains and he said, in formal Arabic, "Behold, a desert of light." Suddenly, I was a little kid again, sitting in our first grade classroom, and my father was giving us an Arabic grammar lesson on how to build a sentence, subject and predicate. And he was writing on the board, "The sky is clear. The moon shines."
Your father was a son of a bitch. Every time I messed up on one of his parts of speech worksheets, he hit me with that ruler. It was fucked up. You remember that time he caught me smoking in the old neighborhood and he smacked me in the face?
After that, I tried to invite him in the dream for coffee, you know, but suddenly there was coffee flooding the stairwell and it was drowning the whole neighborhood, and there was this gigantic poster of Yasser Arafat, you know, the great revolutionary leader Yasser Arafat, and he was holding a cup of coffee and smiling.
Sounds of shelling from afar and nearby, punctuated by moments of silence.
Lena was scared. Truth be told. But it's good she got out. At least she left the shithole behind. But I
can't understand how somebody finally gets the hell out of here and starts waxing nostalgic for this place, like it's some heaven on earth. She was sad, too. She was looking at the camp from a distance like it was a piece of her heart. Her husband couldn't get through the checkpoint, and she stood alone for a while on the other side, 5 feet between them. Her husband was killed. The sniper. But she ran away.
Where'd she go?
God damn it, don't ask me stupid questions. How am I supposed to know where she went? And now it's a million times more dangerous for us to try to get out. Fuck this life.
Where did she go? What happened to her? Yo, don't lie to me.
I'm not lying to you.
Then a burst of bullets.
Now why are you so in love with make-believe? Fine. Do what you want, man. I'm leaving.
Make-believe? What make-believe are you referring to? Man, if you're lying to me, I'll kill you.
What make-believe? What make-believe? Like she stayed in the camp, like any minute, Joe might come knocking on that door asking to see you? Your whole life is make-believe. Like you think you're gonna live through the siege and become some kind of hero? Like you make-believe this whole revolution thing is gonna work out? Your make-believe revolution of birds under siege.
I thought she'd be better off without me. I thought she'd be happier.
She's definitely braver than you. She got through the checkpoints. You can't even get through that door. Wake up, man! That's why she left you here. She couldn't bear your philosophy of nothing.
I have this feeling that she's not okay. What happened to her?
So now, you're worried about her. What were you thinking when you left her to face this fucking life alone, huh? You promised to never
shut the fuck
her
up, man. I don't want to hear it.
Man, don't mess with me right now because I can't stand you anymore. First chance we get, we fly. Get the hell out of here. You follow me? That's the most important thing now. I can hear those stubborn gears grinding in your head. What good does it do you being so stubborn?
If you're that upset about it, why don't you get out now?
I can't leave while the road's still closed, can I? Besides, I'm waiting for a call.
Fine. You get out by yourself. Because I'm not leaving. I'm done with this. Pull it in my back so they can call me a martyr. I am no martyr. And if I ever did want to become a martyr, then it wouldn't be like that. No way. I don't even know what we're doing here. Oh, no, man, don't start that shit, that whole speech about how us being Palestinians and how we've suffered our whole lives and how suffering has made us a strong people. I'm even bored with that, too. The only person making believe here is you, not me. Today, tomorrow, someday, over the rainbow, they'll open the roads and there'll be a truce. Brother, make your own decision. Take matters into your own hands for once in your life. And don't let anyone manipulate you. Manipulate us.
Okay. Take it easy, huh? We can still find a way out. Sit with me. Talk with me.
Very moment. If you could be anywhere, where would you be?
I'd be in the desert.
about northern Morocco. My whole life I've dreamt of living there, man. Fresh culture, strong identity, good, honest people, good, honest weed. What do you think about northern Morocco then? Or maybe the Moroccan Sahara?
Let's do it. Let's go to Morocco.
We can buy a horse.
Yeah, we can get ourselves a horse.
And go galloping over the sand.
No noise, silence all around.
And we roll ourselves a fine, fresh joint.
And we smoke it.
Oh, yes, indeed, we do.
Yes,
we smoke
we
it.
We do.
And maybe you start, like, feeling a little thirsty.
Right. And I see an oasis in the distance.
The music stops.
Of course, Morocco will never take us in. It's not even an option. I'm only talking about Morocco because I have this picture stuck in my head, like the stuff we used to imagine when we were kids back in the day.
Man, quit messing with me.
What are we wasting our time for? Pictures in your head? Morocco back in the day? Do you want to get out or not? Basically, it's not up to you. I'm going to force you out. But you think this is a game? The second they call us, we're out of here.
Look, I'll let you in on a little secret. There'll be no more talking around here until you're well on your way.
Now I'm scared. So what? I'm supposed to shut up until... So that's it? This is how you give up on our dreams?
Give up on our dreams? Man, you sound like you're breaking up with a girl.
Bombing, followed by silence.
Getting out is not a choice, all right? I'm not willing to become a refugee yet again. I can't handle losing my identity. I mean, isn't that clear?
What identity? What bullshit? This camp has become our identity. Wake up, man. Get off your trip. The world's your fucking oyster.
Yeah, for sure. Where are you off to then? Denmark?
Wherever these legs will carry.
Gaza?
Of combat playing circles. Sounds of bombing.
Brother, it's like I told you. I don't want to discuss or talk about anything.
You're scared of the checkpoints.
So don't bullshit me about back in the day and pictures in your head.
You're an idiot, man.
I'm an idiot? Sure. You say that because you know I'm right.
I thought you didn't want to fight with me. Where's the bottle?
He plants his foot on his back, blocks me from opening it.
You're an idiot and you're wrong.
Truth be told, if I was an idiot for coming back here to find you, for thinking for sure you'd wised up by now. Turns out you're more stupid than before. Brother, it only takes a little courage.
It only takes a little courage. Was it courage that got us here? Was it our freedom? Or resistance? Or Israel?
Bombing! Followed by silence.
So now you're gonna stage yourself a protest? And you think that all the people who stayed in the camp are just like you?
Yeah, that's right. All the people who stayed in the camp are just like me.
Sounds of bombing. Very close. Very loud.
All those motherfuckers out there are making a killing off our siege. They stick us in the shit and come up smelling roses.
Man, what are you on about? I mean, can you imagine us becoming refugees twice over? I mean, you think the UN's got some 5-star accommodations planned? No, man, this time we'll be deeper in the shit and more grateful for it.
Because living under siege is better, right?
And what life experience are you talking about? Going to another camp? Same circle, same papers, same organization, same old generation of refugees. My cup runneth over. Man, when are you gonna drop me? Let me go. It's the best thing for you. Go. Live your life. Get out of here. Go.
He pulls a cigarette from his pocket, crosses to the corner, sits, and starts smoking.
Give me a cigarette.
He stands and approaches A as he digs the last cigarette out of his pocket.
Take it, brother. Smoke.
You take everything? You blame everyone else? Sure, brother, because you're the target, the victim of a conspiracy. Oh, blessed be our Savior, son, without whom our holy camp would collapse. This place is a curse. Camps are a curse. Here, take your fucking lighter.
What's wrong with you? Can't shut up for 5 fucking minutes.
There's nothing wrong with me. I'm super. I just gotta go change my shirt.
A stands and starts breaking things. He does not move. A's phone rings. Ring, 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 ring.
It's your boys.
He rises. He lights the last cigarette as he crosses to the phone. Ring, ring, ring.
Hey, brother. You serious, man? For real? No, 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 we'll come down. We're coming down. Wait for us. You wait. We're coming. Bye.
A crosses to the bag and takes out the bottle and drinks most of it. Then water on his hands. He does not notice me as he crosses to tell me they must leave.
Get out of here. Forget about me. Go.
Alright. It's cool. Just stay by yourself like a stray dog. Enjoy yourself.
He goes to the door. He hesitates. Exits. Sounds of heavy bombing. After a moment, B returns.
The building next door is down.
There's still a sip of wine, man, if you need it.
I miss them. The boys are gone.
Grabs him violently by the shirt.
You want to know about Lena? Lena ran away, but they followed her. I could hear her from a distance screaming. If I tried to follow her, they might have killed me. They came back, gave me cigarettes, and promised they'd let you and me out of here. They told me that Lena's still alive.
What'd they do to her? And you standing there, whole time, with your tail between your
legs? I told you she's alive, but you throw a wrench into every plan! For nothing! We're stuck in this hellhole and you think you're Che Guevara? We don't call the shots. Here, that's the situation now, and that's how it's going to be because these motherfuckers need their charity case. They advocate for our inalienable right of return and restitutions and reparation and all that bullshit and make us live a giant lie. Now we're sitting here bearing the brunt of that lie and you can't see this? Then you have a serious problem with yourself that you gotta solve before you die. You're not gonna start a revolution. You're gonna starve to death because no one gives a shit about you.
Phone rings again. Ring, ring, ring. A grabs it and smashes it to pieces.
So now you're a hero. You're the man.
Yes, I am. I am the man. Whether you like it or not. And you know why? Because I stay here. I know what I'm about. Not like you, you vacillating son of a bitch. You're everywhere and nowhere. I, the man. I'm the man. And I stay here.
You're one hell of a liar.
Man, you can't bear to admit that this is how your toxic fate plays out. This fate, this curse. It'll cling to you no matter where you go. You think you'll survive? You're fooling yourself. I'm not leaving here, not because I'm a hero. Think you can provoke me into leaving? I'm staying here in the camp. Here is where we ended, and here is where I stay. I can't bear people staring at me again. like I'm an alien, like I'm unnatural, abnormal, a freak. Man, I'm a human being. I don't want charity from anyone. I left my UN refugee card at home. It went up in flames along with the rest of the house. My only... cremated. No memory of me remains. There are no memories. There are no people who know you or me. I refuse to be a foreigner, a stranger. Where are you from? Palestine. Oh, Palestine. Were you born in Palestine? No. We left in 48. I'm a refugee, a Palestinian refugee. A refugee twice over. And then they look at you with that stupid intensity and they smile. That fake-ass smile. And if they really, really care, they ask you about your people. How can I write my people's testament above the clouds? My people, when they abandon time as they do their coats at home, my people who raise each fortress they build and pitch on its ruins a tent, nostalgic for the beginning of palm trees, my people betray my people in wars over salt.
Considered writing a play. So now you're worried about our people? It's not the story you think it is. Someone asks you where you're from, you tell him Switzerland. It's none of his business. You like some girl, you tell her you're Palestinian. That's normal.
Indeed, my friend, that's why I'm free. I'm a free man, whether you like it or not. I'm the man, whether you like it or not. How can I write clouds, my people, when they abandon time as they do their coats at home, my people, who raise each fortress they build and pitch on its ruins a tent, nostalgic for the beginning of palm trees, my people.
Betray
my people. In wars over salt.
The shelling is on top of them. It shakes the building and shatters the windows. The electricity flashes on and off and then cuts out. The shelling continues for a long moment. They continue speaking in complete darkness.
I'd like to congratulate you on this ending.
I'd like to congratulate you.
Congratulate me for what?
The lights rise. Door opens. A man in military fatigues enters, followed by two other armed men in varieties of civilian dress. The armed men do not look at A or B, nor do A and B look at the armed men. They are in the room together, but they do not pay attention to one another.
I'd like to congratulate you for your whole garbage life and your rusty way of thinking and how you abandon her and let them do that to her. There and defy this whole war.
Man, if you knew this whole time, why didn't you come out and protect her? Why are you hiding in the house? Sitting here hiding like a fucking mouse?
They attack one another. Armed men stream in from every corner of the theater and prepare for vicious hostility. They divide between armed civilians and others in military camouflage. B stops fighting with A. Guy A moves frantically around the order of the chaos. He follows him.
Why do you carry this thing around thinking it's worth something? How can you shame yourself like that? Don't you want to live? You're a coward. You're a nihilist. You're hiding behind a cause because you're scared. You're scared to face a life full of failures. Scared to face a failed love story. Scared it's your own fault. You obsess over the details, like it all happened yesterday, and this pathetic little home we've suffered long and hard to build is now done.
demolished. How could you think the camp is a good place? Because you'd rather stay oppressed. You'd rather die thinking you're a hero. You'd rather play the part of the hero. And that's abnormal. That's unnatural. Because there are no... There is no truth because nothing's real. Even you aren't real. You don't exist. Nobody sees you. You're not even somebody's charity case. There are no more charity cases. The camps are landfills. So what are you protesting?
You hear yourself? Because you're starting to sound like me.
He holds the empty bottle of wine.
See, I'm protesting against you. Yeah, against you. Against everything. Against myself. I'm protesting because it's my right to protest. I'm protesting because there's nothing left to protest. Because after all, man, we are all living in a big camp.
Speak a bit louder if you can.
Okay, so I wrote it in 2013 when I was in Lebanon. And I had friends who were in Yemen and they were under siege. This is not, the characters are not real characters, but I imagined this because I was thinking a lot about them and I didn't want it to be very poetic or unnatural. So this is my second play. I wrote a play that's called Exile. It's was more, the first one was very poetic and very romantic. So I decided to protest against myself and write this one to change this perspective.
So tell us a little bit, you live in Spain at the moment, you also study directing, playwriting, but how did you end up there and how does that feel and how is that? How did that happen?
What do you mean?
In Spain, or how your journey to...
Well, I left Syria in 2012, I went to Lebanon, I lived there for 1 year. I wrote my first draft of Wizard of Light in Lebanon. I finished, I'm studying right now directing and dramaturgy in Malaga, Spain. And I finished writing Wizard of Light through these 3 years.
Vibrant and important Palestinian neighborhood. There were buildings there and restaurants and theaters and this was the area that was under siege. That's under siege in this play and that was in large part destroyed.
Yes.
In 2012. Yeah.
That's when you left.
So
we were. So it's your personal experience. Were you there under the siege?
But I have lots of family and lots of friends who were there.
And how far was it? How far is it? Like a mile, a kilometer?
It's half an hour. From my house.
Mm-hmm. We have also with us here Professor Marvin Carlson, who is also a great colleague at the Graduate Center, a CUNY, a professor of theater history, and was really one of the significant theater historian on planet Earth. So Marvin, one of his many fields of study is Arab theater. Marvin, this play, where do you think, where does it fit in and what?
Well, it, people generally in the West, when you use a term, Frank, like Arab theater, they think there's some kind of monolithic or more or less monolithic kind of theater. The very first thing you must say about the Arab theater, as you must say about the Arab world as a whole, is that this is a very, very large cultures and countries in it. I can't talk about this play as an Arab play. I mean, I don't know what an Arab play is. This is, it seems to me, however, very distinctly a Palestinian play. But that also, I mean, that's like saying it's a French play or a German play or a United States play. The Palestinian theater is a much more recent theater than, let's say, the Egyptian theater or the Syrian theater. It is a theater that, more than any other theater in the Arab world, has been a theater created in crisis and siege and under pressure. And one thing you can say generally about the Arab theater is that it is much more frequently concerned with social and political questions than the Western theater. I mean, this is a comparative matter. But this, if that's true of the Arab theater in general, it's particularly true of the Palestinian theater. The theater in every culture must address the concerns that are occupying the people of that culture. It's hard to imagine that the Palestinian theater would not be a theater that is a theater continually dealing with how do you deal with the continuing and extreme cycle. very frequently are two character plays. I think that's an interesting thing to think about. Why is that? Well, partly because there's a practical matter. It's much harder to do a 20 character play when you're working in very limited theatrical conditions. But also, this really strips things down to the plays being almost internal monologues. It is, and I think that's very much true of this play. It is almost as though here we have a contemporary Palestinian consciousness that's enormously conflicted within itself. You often feel the characters almost switch places. They bounce off each other, again, like somebody arguing internally. And I would say that the key question of the play, and this also seems to be very typical, if you're speaking generally about modern Palestinian development, is where do I find a ground upon which to stand? What am I? What is a Palestinian? Where am I? Where am I as a human being? What can I do? The characters realize that be fair. You get a lot of this in contemporary Israeli drama as well, as what we've taken this position, we've taken that position, but now we suddenly realize that we've been manipulated all along. This is at one time we believed in this rhetoric or that rhetoric or whatever, and that is now collapsed, and we don't know where to replace it. And it seems to me that the exploration of that anxiety is really at the heart of the play, and of course overlaid with the continual pressure of the bombing, the shooting, and so on, and of course the fact that they are trapped. It's very theatrical in the sense that one of the great things that theater does is show entrapment. Theater loves to show entrapment. That's one reason why so many plays take place in living rooms people can't get out of. Ibsen, O'Neill, you know, people love to. I mean, we love to watch people who can't get out. Lewis Miller. I mean, just go down the list. And what could be a worse entrapment than to be entrapped in a semi-tomb with bullets flying? Anyway, I've talked too long.
Thank you very much. And it's true, and it's also the way looking for the exit, as we have in the sign here, like in all literature. Hey, what could be one? Rebecca, you and we talked about the Pinball Voices Festival. Colleagues, you said this play is something you really have to do, Rama Kane. Why do you think this is such a strong voice within global theater?
So I'm interested broadly in theater of protest and political theater, and I'm interested in theater that's really trying to question entrenched power structures, so these deeper structures that are controlling these characters' lives, for example. And I'm also interested in pushing our contemporary conversation in the US. So whenever I look for a play to translate, I'm also looking for a play that I think can provoke the US audience. Because for me, it's not only about this Palestinian story. Obviously, it's very vividly about these two Palestinian characters and about them being under siege. But for me, more broadly, it's about many people around the globe who are born into incredibly oppressive situations, under poverty, living in violence. They don't choose this situation. They didn't choose to be living in this area. They don't choose to be suddenly, trapped inside of a war, or even, if I may be so bold to say, trapped within a violent, poverty-ridden neighborhood in this country, or kind of part of that, prison pipeline that we have here. And I'm interested in the ways in which this kind of drama can both tell us about another culture and also force us to understand what we have in common and the things that we need to examine in our own society. And that's in particular why I was interested in this play. And that's just on a political level, but then of course I'm also looking for, are the characters interesting? Is the dialogue sharp? What's the rhythm of the play? And I felt like this had all of those things at the heart of this piece. And I'm also particularly interested in a play in which I think is, when we are given or when we see images of Palestinians, it's usually very a kind of dichotomy between either a terrorist or a victim or someone who's totally Western and secular or totally reactionary and Muslim. So we have these dichotomies that we're constantly presented with by the mainstream media. And these characters, and Marvin touched on that, they're incredibly complex and in some ways confusing. And they're not embodiments of these strict political ideologies. They're full-fledged human beings. And that's another reason that I think we're interested in any kind of drama. That it's getting at that core of that central, like that internal conflict of the character. So it has all of these elements to it. And also, was the person who introduced me actually to both of the playwrights, who to the next playwright as well, and said, Rama is an extraordinary young talent and you should read her work.
Good to listen to friends,
yes,
and colleagues. And Ra, has the play been done in Syria, in Spain, in Lebanon? What is the production history so far of it? And
in general,
yes.
Well, in Syria right now,
a bit louder if you can speak.
In Syria right now, things are a little bit crazy.
Of course.
With producing art, I mean, it's very radical to. With the government to build independent cultural art inside the country. You know what I mean? But outside the country, there's lots of interesting movement, art movement, theater movement, and transformation for this experience of war.
Of a network is there of Arab artists, theater artists outside the Arab world? I mean, I realize there's now a very large expatriate community. I know a woman who runs an Arabic theater. I know there, and there's work in Germany, of course. Are you connected with other expatriate artists in any kind of formal or informal way? What kind of communication is there, or is there much?
Well, actually, to be honest, like to build our own association or organization of theater as a Syrian Arab independent artists, it's a little bit hard. Because we are facing very difficult moment with living. It's a challenge to live. It's a challenge to take papers, a residency. We are focusing now on being stable.
Survivals.
Mm-hmm. Then we will try to be connected with this kind of, I hope so.
Before we come to audience questions, who do you read? Who do we refer to? Who are your writers that inspire you? And usually, who are your references? What writers?
I pretty much like to read for UNESCO.
UNESCO?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And
I heard a little bit of Observer's
Theater. Yes, yeah. I'm very, very. Absurd in general, like Beckett and modern contemporary absurd theater too. In this play, actually, but we are, it's real, you know?
Yeah.
Especially yeah. With what's happening in the world, not only in Syria.
Yeah, I think, you know, the great tradition also of absurd theater in Eastern Europe came because the reality was so absurd. If you would show on stage something that makes sense or was logical, you would say, that's absurd. You know, that's not how things work. And of course, it's a way to really also deal with terrible, you know, traumatic events and disaster and life-threatening situations where, as we all know, the refugee crisis, which is hitting Europe, and in a little way also America, but especially also Europe, so hard. People walking over, you know, over thousands, over hundreds of miles, and being on ships trying to cross. What is your hope, you know, for using a theater instead of poetry, painting, or other? What is your belief in that art form as an expression?
Taking a stand through art and express the individual, not only causes, and be part of this kind of expression to maybe change something.
Well, we do have some time, right, to take a couple of questions or just comments. It doesn't have to be a question or something. We'll have to speak a little bit louder yet over here.
Hi, thank you very much for this. I'm wondering, back in Damascus, what culture were you experiencing, and did it in Syria? Was there any kind of painting, poetry, music, or theater that you experienced in the audience that helped you or that gave you some experience in relation to being Palestinian in Syria?
Actually, I studied in Damascus in the Higher Institute of Dramatic Arts, and there's a great artist there who are trying to be out of this bubble of dictatorship that we're living in, because you can't really express too much. You can talk about everything you want. So, but what was happening is that we were trying to bring and to read and to participate in theater festivals and bring theater festivals and bring theater ensembles from all over the world. And that was, for example, in Damascus, capital of culture, in 2008, we experienced lots of interesting plays and theater, contemporary theater, and
I was interested in your experience as a refugee living in Europe, because of the huge debate that now is going on in Europe about all these people that, you know. What do you make of this debate? Are there things there that you would be interested as an artist, as a writer?
Do you mean in the country that I'm living in?
Yeah.
Or
how do you live your condition as a refugee in Europe with all the debates that's going on, and basically there's like Europe dividing people who, you know, would like to just shut the doors, whoever is not here, and people who are welcoming, helped, you know, open to this.
I mean, I would like to just say that this is what the play is talking about, and just to refer back to Ron's work, because I think one of the perspectives that we get from this play very much, which we really do not get from the mainstream media, is that they don't want to be foreigners, for the love of God, you know? There is no sense that these two characters want to leave. There already have been refugees. They were born in in Syria. They're Palestinians who were born in Syria, but they have somehow created some home there. They do not want to leave and be foreigners twice over. So I think that that perspective, I think whenever we, when a lot of times when I hear reporting on refugees, on the refugee crisis, there's this notion that these people are trying to come to the U.S. and that they want to be here. No, they want to be in their homes, and they want to be where they're not foreigners, and they want to be where they have an identity, and they have their own language, etc. And I feel like that's very strong in this piece, and that it's an important perspective. With a drama in which two characters have no good choices. There is no, they could stay in this abandoned house that they're hiding out in and die. They could try to escape and die. So that's, I think, the perspective we really, I hope, hits home with this piece.
Yeah, and that's why it would be interesting in your personal experience, because, you know, I guess...
Well, let's maybe go to another question.
Hi, thank you very much for your play. So I noticed that the two main characters were male, and the only two females sort of mentioned. One was like gang raped, I guess, and the other was the mother. So I was wondering, how would the play have been different if the two main characters were female? Or was there, sorry, is this a...
No, this is a question, it's so interesting. So so the question, for those of you who didn't hear it, is what would happen if, you know, it's really interesting. Rama, she's a woman playwright, and she's writing about these two male characters, and that the female character that we hear about, she's raped. So where is the female voice here, and what would happen if the two characters were actually two women?
First of all, who said that women should write about women and men?
Sorry, I don't mean to assume that. And then how would it have been different?
Yeah,
if they,
I know.
Sorry.
If they were two women, there will be no drama, because they will leave. And the very first time they were our mother, they have not. I'm not saying anything, but it's real. Women are mothers. They have this sense of surviving and protecting thing, you know. And men likes to show that they are strong. Handle this, and they can do it, and they can. That's why there's this big question that one of the characters are always questioning: should we leave or should we? Questions: should we be heroes or should we be normal persons? Because women, really, I'm telling you, I'm not being radical, but. They will leave. They will find their way. They will, I don't know, they won't be in this kind of absurdity kind of situation.
But in a sense, their dialogue reflects your thoughts. So you do have these thoughts.
Yeah, I have these thoughts. But
the practical effect, you left.
It's not thoughts, actually.
Okay.
It's questions.
Mm. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
There's a voice in the play, it's called, My Name is Rachel Corey. It's a voice of a sort of a Palestinian view, but it's done by an American young person. I don't know if you know that play. That's when I think about Palestinian, I think of causes, I think of Rachel Corey's perspective, which is actually an American perspective, or a perspective of a young person who's trying to fight for a cause. And I just wondered what you thought of, you're trying to tell a story from the Syrian point of view. I wonder what you thought of, if you know that play, or if you have any.
I didn't read it.
Let me just say a word about the play. It seems to me that Rachel Corey, although it's a play that I like very much, I think it's a very important play. We know, partly because it is an important play. But having said that, I would say that yes, you're quite right to say it is very much an American play, seems to me that the Rachel Corey position occurs in this play as something in the past. That is, this is a position which talks about, they talk at some length about the feeling sorry for the Palestinian going back to 1948 and how they've been betrayed and how much they've suffered and all that. All of that is now rhetoric. It's all part of a structure that in fact has just been used to manipulate them. Now that's where Rachel Corey is, and I think that the characters in this play are years beyond that, and not in a good way. That is the just feeling. The Palestinians are being oppressed. We've got to go up and stand in front of the tanks. They're beyond that. They're beyond gestures. That's sad, but that's where they are. It would be like if you went to the characters of Waiting for Godot and you said, "Don't you admire the guy who stood up at the tanks in Tiananmen Square?" What would the guys at Waiting for Godot say? What's that? I mean, even if they knew what it was, it's just an idle gesture. It doesn't mean anything. Situation, even though it is dealing with the same geopolitical problem. That is one of, and this goes back to what Rebecca said, one of the reasons why it is so important to have voices, and this goes to the pan-world authors, is that important as the Rachel Corey story is, and truly it is very important, it is equally important to realize there are many other perspectives on this same problem. And one of the best places to find them out is with dramatists.
So from Syria, yeah.
Well, I had a question about when I don't remember where the play was, the piano plays and they start dreaming for a moment of, I believe it was Morocco, maybe you misheard that. I was just curious whether it's commanding that you're repeating that they're not dreaming about Europe or the United States, dreaming about a place that they know. And I was just curious about that. I mean, it's not something I would have ever thought of. I was curious about the use of that.
Why Morocco?
Why Morocco, and what that means to you and to people in that area.
I assume you wrote this originally in Arabic,
yes.
And you're seeing it read in English. How much of this translation do you think is true to what you, and I'm not criticizing the translation, of course, but I want to know if there are things in your original Arabic that got lost in translation, or if you saw everything come out when you hear it in English.
She's a very decent translator, and I didn't have any problems with finding the dialect of the characters and transforming that into English. Of course, it's different. If you will read it in Arabic, it's a little bit different because...
What what would you say is different? I'm trying to see if there's something that doesn't come out in another language, not just English, but is specific to this play in Arabic.
The personality of every character. Mm-hmm. Because it's not the language who helps you to know the personality of a person. I'm talking English, but if I'm talking in Arabic, I will be better.
One just quick question, kind of connected to that. The poem that is recited, is that in colloquial Arabic or is that in formal Arabic in the original?
No, that's the poem that's recited in the play is a Mahmoud Darwish poem, and it's in Fusha. It's in formal Arabic. Yeah, but I think I just
because they mention the importance of formal Arabic once in the play.
Yeah.
And it occurs to me that this is always a challenge for a translator.
Yes.
How do you get across that? Because when they move into...
Well, I mean, in this particular play, Marvin, it's interesting because the English is actually very colloquial. And I think one of the, Brahma and I translated it together. And so one of the things that we were talking about is that and it's a challenge because these guys they're very smart in a way. They're autodidacts. They're educated, but they've also been kind of rough guys. They're not kind of urban intellectuals who are sitting in an ivory tower. And I think that it's very important. So when you're translating, I think one of the really big challenges is how do you translate, in a sense, class? How do you translate? If someone's coming from a background where they need to be tough and they need to sound tough and they need to be able to speak in a kind of brutal way sometimes, how do you translate that into English and how do you find that equivalent? And so that's something I'm very interested in, and I think that in particular going from the very colloquial language that they use. Into the Mahmoud Darwish poem, I mean, suddenly he's reciting this beautiful poetry. And so in that sense, in this particular translation, I felt like it actually was quite a jump, and it worked in a similar way as Fusha and Amiya would work.
Well, I do think that a play does really show us the many, many levels, the complexities and the contradictions, of life, human existence, but also that very, very special experience of a displaced person displaced one more time. In another place, and who knows what your next step and then also and will be. And we would like to thank you for traveling here all the way, for coming. To reflect what you all said, we should not just talk about the Palestinians, about the refugee crisis, also listen to really people who come from there and hear their voices and understand their reality, and I think this is why your such place is so important. So Marvin, also thank you for coming. You're also staying for the next one. Everybody here, but again, thank you so much, and thank you all.